So we had discussed super keyword. There are two types of the super keyword. One is the super call, one is the super dot. So, you know, we are using the inheritance concept. So we have a super class and subclass, but we are creating the object of the subclass. But someone will ask how the super class member will get memory. So what will happen? If you are creating a class, any class, by default compiler is added the constructor. Okay, so when the compiler added the constructor, coming session I will come in the constructor. Okay, what is the use of the constructor and all, I will discuss. So what will happen after constructor? We have a super calls. Okay, so by default what will happen, this super call, while getting the super call, when you are created the object of the subclass, you know, then the super class member will get the memory. So one thing, when we are, this is the by default constructor and super call is added by the compiler, okay, when you are compiling the code. But when we are using the super call explicitly, when we have a parameterized constructor, we are, if you are passing the parameter inside this constructor, at that time we will use the super call, you know, explicitly. Means if you will not use, your code will not work, means it will get the compile time error. Another keyword was like super dot. So when we are using the super dot, we have a super class member and subclass member. The super class member and subclass member having the same name. So which, but how to access the super class? If int a equal to 10, if int b equal to 20, in the super class I have declared, and same variable I have declared in the subclass. But you have to access, when you will simply, you know, compile this code and run this code, then what will happen? Your subclass member will be, you know, printed, means displayed. But I want to be access this super class member. So at that time we will use the super dot. So this thing we had already discussed. So now I will share my screen. So this is the also the discussed topic, not a big deal, but sometime. So we have some important notes, you know, call within the same class for non-static member. Okay, so what will happen? This on non-static and static we have a lot of the time, but I have a one more concept. So this, you know, this call within the same classes, I will give you the example also, I will relate after that. So what will happen? If you have a, for non-static member, we have a non-static member. What is the non-static member? Non-static variable, non-static block, constructor, and non-static method. These are the non-static member. So what will happen for a static context? A static context means a static area. We cannot call non-static member directly. Okay. We already discussed this system, but just for your clarification, I'm giving one more example. Then we can call using those non-static member by using this object class. So we have a one class, and inside this, as a class level, I declare non-static variable, and that non-static variable I want to access in the static context. Then we have to create an object, right? So I will give the example of this. But if you have a non-static context here means a static, non-static area. So we can call using the non-static member without using, you know, without using it's a class object. Okay. So in this case, what will happen? You know, if you are accessing the non-static member in the non-static context, we have a non-static variable. I want to access that variable in the non-static method. So I will come in the example, then I will show you also. Then you have to, there is no need to create an object. But why? Someone will ask, why there is no need to create an object? Because internally what will happen in this case, at the time of compilation, compiler add current class object in the calling non-static from non-static context, means what will happen? Compiler add by default this keyword. So I will come in the this thing. I will show you in the practical also this theory. I will show you in the practical. Friends, simple conclusion, if you are creating any non-static member, by default compiler add this keyword. So there is no need to create an object when you are creating the non-static member, when you are accessing the non-static member in the non-static context. A static, we knows, in a static member we can call the directly with its name from the both static context or non-static, because it get the memory at the time of execution. We have a two variable is there as a class level. One is the static variable, one is the non-static variable. But I want to access both a static and non-static variable in the static context, means a static area. So what will happen? You can create an object as your choice, and you can call, you know, directly, because at the time of the class loading, only a static member will get memory. Okay. So non-static member, this step, okay, this is, okay, one more thing. For non-static member, get memory at the time of execution, and it is common to all object of the particular class. Means simply non-static member, when you are creating an object, class, at that time, you know, a static member will get memory, okay. So non-static member get memory when object is created, in it the specified, you know, that object. Means non-static member will get memory when object is created. That is the, you know, this stuff I will discuss in this example. So simple what I want to tell in this session. Okay, so what we are doing, we have a one class thing, which is the class, I did not copy this. I can create another class name also, but no problem. So here you can see I have only within the one class how to access in the non-static context and a static context. Okay, once again. Okay, so what I am doing here, you can see here we have a class level variable, a static and non-static variable. We have a static and non-static variable, right? A static and non-static. So you can see this area is called a static context, sorry, non-static context. So I want to access this, you know, a static and non-static. Okay, so what will happen in this, okay, first I not compiling this. Okay, so this non-static, if you want to access in this non-static context, the static and non-static, so you have to call this method, right? This is the non-static method, right? Then we have to call this method. So this is the non-static, we have created an object and simply we are calling this. Now if your simple conclusion is this, in non-static context you can access a static and non-static directly. There is no need to, you know, create an object, right? Here this is the non-static. But why we are you know, able to access this non-static without creating an object, because in by default, you know, compiler is adding this keyword here. Okay, so what is the job of this keyword? In coming session I will discuss. But here you can see this is the static context. This is the static context, right? This in this static context, if you want to access, you know, a non-static area is non-static. Sorry, a static. But if you want to access this non-static, then you have to create an object here. So that's why we will get same output, and this static we can call directly, right? No need to create an object. So this thing I want to discuss here. This is happening in the same class. Okay. So this thing just want to discuss. Oh, I did not call. So you can see this non-static method I can call directly. Sorry, a static method, right? There is no need to create an object. So we are getting 10 and 20. So this theory, whatever the theory I have given, same example I related with this theory. Okay, so this is the thing. and call from the other class. So this thing we have already know, right? A static member can call either using the class name or using the object of that class. So this thing happened in the same class, right? But how to access in the different class means when you are performing the inheritance concept. So we had already know this, but for your confusion and your clarification, I had discussed here. So non-static member can be called only, you know, object of the particular class, either the static context or non-static context. But same thing, just your clarification. So before, what I am doing here, before we have done this stuff in the same class, but here the static and non-static we are performing in superclass and subclass, means how to access one class to another class, right? So this is the static and non-static, so this is the not a big deal, just what I am doing here. This static you can call directly, non-static you have to create an object, right? And one more thing, this static you can access by the object class also. This static you can access by the class name also. Okay, so this thing means static you can access directly, you can access the object, and you can access the class name as well. Okay, this thing I want to discuss here. So static member you can access by using the class name, you can access directly, you can access the object by using the object class. So this is the stuff. So introduction of the this keyword. Okay, so what is the use of the this keyword? I will discuss. Okay, after the constructor is there. Okay, in the last class I had discussed about of this keyword, but what is the use of this keyword and why we are using the this keyword? So this is the definition of the this keyword. What is the keyword? This is the non-static final reference variable. This is what non-static final reference variable used to store current object reference to separate non-static variable of the different in the non-static context. In the variable topic we had discussed how to differentiating between class level variable and local variable. So at that time we had used this keyword, but we will learn what is the use of this keyword again, and we'll give you the example also. So simple thing, if you are creating any non-static member, then by default this keyword is added by the compiler. But some other use of also, we are using the in the coding we have a different concept of the this keyword. So I will tell you where we are using this keyword. Okay, so what happened, how will place this keyword in the calling non-static member from the other non-static member, then what will happen in compilation phase? Compiler places this keyword in all non-static member if they are called directly by their name. So what will happen, this is the source code. Source code means just we have written this code, okay, without compilation. Just developer had created this code, but he did not compile, okay, this code. So this is called source code. But what happened if you are just, this is the source code, I did not compile this, just you can see here only non-static member are there, only non-static, right? Non-static variable, non-static method, and this is also non-static. So after compilation what will happen, this is the compilation code. After compilation what will happen, by default this keyword is added by compiler. Okay, by default this keyword is added by the compiler. Okay, if after compilation by default this keyword is added by the compiler. Okay, so now I cannot show you here, but I can give the proof of this. If I compile this, okay, just we compile this code, right? So we are getting 10, 20 and method 1. So just this is the non-static method and non-static variable and non-static method. Again, non-static method. Just we are, you know, printing this x and y, right? And just I call this method here. Okay. So if I will call this method, what happen? If I will call this method will be execute. After execution of this method, you know, method is executing line by line. So this method will also execute m1, then this method will be execute also. So when m2 will execute, then m1 will also execute. By default, this keyword is added by compiler. Okay, by default, this keyword is added by the compiler for all non-static. So what will happen if I will compile this? Same output will come. Right, same output will come. So if you are not adding this keyword, then by default this keyword is added by the compiler. So this is the compilation code. After compilation, internally this thing happen. Okay. So this I'll just revise this step. Okay, in the previous session we had already discussed this code, but I'll just explain once this code. So here I use this keyword also and super dot also. Okay, so okay, now we have a non-static variable here and we have a one constructor here. Okay, class name and constructor name is same. Okay, you can see here this variable name x by and in the super class and the subclass is same. Okay, in the super class and subclass is the same here. Okay, now again I use this constructor here. Okay, so constructor I will come and I will discuss. Okay, but if you want, if I will call this m1 method, if I will call this m1 method, I want to print x and y, then which variable will be printed? Okay, so now if I will compile this, because the variable name, superclass variable name and subclass variable name is same, but if I will compile this code, you can see here we are getting the output is 30 and 40. Okay, but why we are getting this output is 30 40? By default compiler is added this keyword. Okay, the what is the job of this keyword? This keyword is referencing this current reference variable. So this current reference variable is this, refer this current reference variable. Okay, so that's why here we are getting the, you know, output is 30 and 40. Someone will ask what is the reason we are getting the 30 40, then you can tell this reason. By default what will happen, compiler will add this keyword, and this keyword, the job of the this keyword, it refer from current reference variable. Okay, one thing. But someone will ask how to access this superclass variable. So superclass variable, why we have a one another keyword is called super dot. So by using this super dot, we are able to access this. Okay, so we are able to compile and we are able to execute this. So we are getting that 10 and 20 output. So this is the job of this keyword, but we have another job also of this keyword. So this is the, you know, where we are using this keyword for storing the current object reference variable. Okay, differentiating this variable, we had already discussed in this, you know, when I taught you variable chapter in the topic. So differentiating non-static variable from one object to another object. Okay, another job of for accessing the variables means non-static variable and method, non-static method of the current class from the another class method. Okay, so this is the job of this keyword for accessing the constructor of the current class from the other overloaded constructor. So this point we'll discuss in the later. Okay, for differentiating the non-static variable from the parameter if the both have a same name, right? So this thing we had already, you know, discussed. Okay, so in the collection I will give you some example for constructor having where we are using this keyword. Okay, so it will get clear. Okay, so all the point will get clear, but here two and three point we have already seen. Since this differentiating this non-static from the one another method for accessing the variable and method for the current class and this stuff. For accessing this constructor, we are not seeing now. Differentiating non-static variable from the parameter in the both having the same name. So two point we did not discuss of the this, but coming session you will get it. Okay. So next topic is the constructor. What is the job of the constructor? So in the last session, I think we have already seen, if you are creating any object, no, so any class, demo class, okay, this class, if I save this demo, okay, this class I save this here. What is the class name? So by default compiler is added the constructor. Okay, so this class I save here. I'll go in the my location, I'll show you. I did not compile right now. This is the source code. I did not compile this. Now if I will go in this location, where is, so I'll search this. Okay, so now you can get it. This is the code, my code, right? This is the code I have written. This is the source code, whatever I have written here, right? But now if I will compile this code, then what will happen? Just I compile this code. Okay, now I will go in the same location and I will search again. So before we are getting only this source code, but after compilation we have getting this compiled code. So in my system we have a one software called decompiler. So in your system you will not get, you have to install the decompiler in your system, then you will get this compile code. So what will happen after compilation, what is happening? By default compiler added this constructor. Okay, so this constructor we are going to learn, what is the job of this constructor, why this compiler added this constructor. Okay, why we are using this constructor? So by default, you know, compiler is added this constructor. You can see this class name and constructor name is same. So now we will discuss what is the constructor. Okay, so constructor is a special method giving in the OOPS language for creating and initializing an object. When you are creating this object, we are using this constructor, right? This is the, you know, class name and constructor name same, right? So in the definition I have written this stuff. What is the job of constructor? Constructor is a special type of method, okay, giving in the OOPS language for creating and initializing an object. Creating means by new keyword we are creating an object, and job of this constructor means we are initializing an object. Okay, for initializing, that's why we are using this constructor. When you are creating a class after compilation, by default this constructor is created by the compiler, added by this compiler, because this class is initial, you know, this object is for initialization purpose. Compiler is added this constructor. Okay, so this is the job of the constructor. In the Java, constructor is only initialize the object. The job of constructor is only initialization. Okay, this is only initialization. And for and new keyword role means creating an object. This new means we are creating an object, and this constructor means we are initializing an object. So this is the job of constructor. Okay, so some rules of the constructor. Okay, so rules for defining the constructor. Constructor name should be same as class name, we know already. It should not have a return type. Okay, I will come in this. This is the important step. Okay, it should not contain any access modifier, non-access modifier. Non-access means a static final. Okay, if you will use this static, what will happen? Static. So you can't use this non-access modifier. You will get compile time error. Okay, so where is it? Okay, so its logic return a statement with value is not allowed. So here return type is not allowed return a statement is not allowed, return with value is not allowed. So this is the rules, and this is the rules of the constructor. What is applicable for the constructor? It can have all the access modifier are allowed. Access modifier means public stat, this public, there are four types of the access modifier. So if you will use this, so nothing will happen, it will compile this. So accessibility modifier is allowed, okay, public, private, protected, right, default. This is the accessibility modifier. We had already discussed accessibility modifier. So it can have all the accessible modifier are allowed. It can have parameters. You can pass the parameter as well. It can have a throw clause. Throw clause, it will come in the exception handling. So throws clause is also allowed. It means we can throw exception from the constructor as well. So we'll discuss in this step in throws clause in exception handling when I will come in this. We can place return a statement in the constructor. Okay, here control is the return is not allowed with value. Okay, we can place only return a statement, but with value you can't allow this. Okay, in the constructor we cannot, we can have any logic except return a statement with value. Okay, so this is the constructor of the syntax, class name, and this class name and constructor name is same. All Java illegal statement are allowed except return statement with value. Return statement with value is not allowed inside this constructor. Okay, so rule in calling the constructor, how to call this constructor? Constructor must be placed call along with new keyword, or else you will lead to compile time error. Okay, when you are creating an object, so if you will not use this new keyword, then what will happen? You are not able to call this constructor. Okay, so this is not a big deal. Like we have created this, let's say this class, I think we have this class already, not able to copy. So just why I'm copying, because not a typo error. If typo error will come, then we will get compile time error. Okay, so just what we are doing, this is the calling of the constructor. Okay, this we are calling this constructor. So what will happen now? This is the simplest step we had already discussed in this type of the example. Okay, so we are able to compile this code and we are able to run this code. Okay, but if you will not use this new keyword, it won't be work. So you have to, you know, use the new keyword while, you know, calling this constructor. Otherwise compiler is not able to find this, cannot find the symbol. Okay, so first rule for the calling the constructor. Okay, so can be defined a method with same class name? Yes, this is the important step. Yes, it is allowed to define a method with same class name. No compile time error or no runtime error is raised, but it is not recommended to use as per coding standard. What will happen? This is the important question. Okay, this is the important question. So the question is that can we define the method with same class name? Yes, you can do that, but what will happen? You will not get any compile time error, any runtime error, but as a coding standard it is not recommended to use. If we place the return type in the constructor, prototype will lead to be a compile time error. So if you will use, you know, return type, then what will happen? Will you get the compile time error? No, you will not get any compile time error, because compiler and JVM consider as a, it is a method. So what will happen if you are using this, you know, okay, so this is important stuff. Okay, in the interview they can ask this question, definitely, if the interviewer having the good knowledge in Java. So what we are doing here, we know that constructor name and class name is same, and we already discussed the return type is not allowed in the constructor. But if you will use constructor with the return statement, right, we have used this void keyword, then what will happen? It is considered as a method. Okay, it is not a constructor, right? Someone will ask, if you will use method name as a class name, then what will happen? This constructor will become this method. Okay, but it is not recommended to use as a coding standard. Okay, what will happen? If you will use this, then the developer will get confused. Okay, this is the constructor or what? Okay, so what will happen if I will call this method? So here, this is the constructor call. This is the constructor call and this is the method call. Okay, so if I will compile this. So we are able to compile this and we are able to run this. So here in this example is very important. Ask to someone this question. Can I use class name as a method? So definitely the people will confuse here. Your question is, yes, I can use this, but as a coding standard, it is not recommended to use. Okay, so this is the important note for this constructor. The next topic is object-oriented programming language. Okay, but two people are absent. And important topic is object-oriented programming language, but I will give you a little bit what is the object-oriented programming language. Okay, Java is very famous for right now in the IT sector. For every profile is depend on the code Java. Okay, if you are going at a testing, if you are going at a DevOps development, lot of the thing, Java support profile is there, lot of the thing is there, but every company is looking for the you are good in the core Java. Now in nowadays the Python comes, but the Python, how to learn this Python if you having the good concept of the core Java, right? So that's why if you learn this, Java is the centralized technology. So every company is looking, do you have a knowledge of the code Java? If you are going to the any profile, if you are testing any profile in the IT, if you are going to the any profile and you know the code Java, then they will consider your profile definitely. Because Java is object-oriented programming language. Object-oriented, what is the meaning of the object-oriented programming language? What will happen? If you will start any business, like I want to start the e-commerce business, right? So what will happen, that e-commerce business having the lot of the requirement, right? I can give you the one requirement of the payment gateway of while using this e-commerce, right? So what will happen while developing the software e-commerce site? So we having a lot of the stuff we have to concentrate about that. Another example, we can give the net banking, right? So net banking have one requirement, like I'm the client, like ICICI Bank. Okay, ICICI Bank is there, but ICICI Bank people doesn't know about of the software, but they have a requirement. These guys will go to the software company and they will tell to the requirement. Okay, so the banking application, very important thing is that security. Okay, if application is not secured, then all the money will gone, right? Huge losses. So why it is secured? So one more concept. So what will happen if you are creating this banking application? So bank is a object, right? Here the bank is a object. Okay, this bank is a object, but someone will ask, this object means our requirement, you have to come in the programming world, how it will come? So Java has given one concept that is called class. So this class, what we can do when you are writing this class keyword, this object will be converted into the programming world. Okay, this is converted into the programming world. This bank is converted into the programming world, means after that we will comes the security. Security is important, right? So again the OOPS concept has given, the concept is called encapsulation. So by using this encapsulation, we can perform the security of the banking application. Okay, but sometime what will happen, our implementation don't want to disclose to anyone, I am the users of the net banking, but I don't know how they have developed this net banking application. Internally what is happening, I don't know. So what will happen, this concept is called abstraction. Abstraction means you, whatever you have a requirement, only you knows that thing. If you are going to ATM machine, so what will happen, I have a ATM card, I know my ATM card, I know how much amount I want to withdraw from the ATM card, I know my PIN number, so this is my requirement, I know that. This is not banking, bank people will tell you, okay. But if you are inserting this ATM machine, you know, card in the ATM machine, but how this internally working the ATM machine, you doesn't know. So this is called abstraction. This is called abstraction means hiding the, you know, implementation details. And only the user, whatever the user have a requirement, only that requirement, only user knows. You don't know about what is the internally happening and what is the all the stuff is how they are working this ATM machine. So this is called abstraction. Inheritance means, I can give you one more example of inheritance and polymorphism. Inheritance means we are acquiring the properties, right? Like we have a 100 classes, right? According to the requirement, we will, you know, extend the all the classes. But how will you call these classes? Okay, so by using this, you know, extend keyword, we are making the relationship between one classes to another class. And whatever the class having, you know, if you are performing the inheritance, just you have to execute only one class, right? Only you have to execute subclass only, then automatically all the classes will be executed. So, you know, what will happen? It reduces the complexity of the code. Next is the polymorphism. Polymorphism means having the multiple form. So in the polymorphism, one concept is called dynamic method dispatching. So dynamic method dispatching, it will use for the reusability purpose. I can give you the software company having the requirement for the ICICI Bank, HDFC Bank, Axis Bank, IDB Bank, okay, State Bank of the India. So five client will go in the, you know, one software company, but software company have already developed one code which is common for the all banking application, right? Which is common for the all banking application. Means what happened, the ICICI Bank having the little bit, they want to be a different step, HDFC having a little bit new feature they want to add it, State Bank having the new feature, but the lot of the common implementation they having already having, okay. So inside this polymorphism, so what will happen, the common implementation they already develop, only they will add new features of the application. So inside this polymorphism, we have a concept of called runtime polymorphism and compile time polymorphism. I will come in this, I will discuss. So inside this, we have a, that is called the dynamic method dispatching. So dynamic method dispatching means I am using HDFC ATM card, but in my area, there is no HDFC ATM is there, but I am able to withdraw, you know, from any ATM machine, right? I have only one object, right? I have only one object, that is called ATM, HDFC ATM card, okay, but I am able to access in any ATM machine. That is called, this concept is called dynamic method dispatching. Okay, so people are not there, but only for this theory is there inside this. I'll come in the coding part, in the OOPS concept, have a coding for the encapsulation and polymorphism. Okay, abstraction we will discuss in the interface and abstract class will come, then I will discuss. So just I will give you this introduction of whatever I have discussed. So what is OOP and why OOP? So OOP is a methodology. It provides the suggestion for implementing real world object in programming world. So if you are going to the any company, they can ask, can you tell me what is the OOP concept and why OOP concept? So OOP concept are given for the implementing real world object in the programming world for automating the real world business operation by achieving the security, dynamic method dispatching. Okay, so this dynamic method dispatching we are achieving by the polymorphism. Okay, I had given one example of this. For representing real world object, OOP has a concept called class. Okay, for achieving security, OOP have a concept called encapsulation. Okay, for achieving dynamic method dispatching, OOP have a concept called abstraction, inheritance and polymorphism. Okay, so representing an object means creating a class with this object name, with variable, method and a storing for value for this object and implementing its operation. Okay, so representing the object means what we are doing. Okay, same step. Achieving security means not allowing the other programmer to access object data directly, allowing only other programmer to access the object data with the proper validation and authentication. I can give you one example. If net banking is there, right? But net banking, I'm not able to access your net banking, right? You are only able to access this net banking. So here this is called security. What will happen when we are registering all the information in the net banking? I am the new customer of this HDFC bank, but they want some information, right? So what the information want? My name and PAN card and Aadhaar card and username and password is important. What will happen? All the information will be stored in the database. Okay, so internally what will happen? Only I am able to access this. So that guy here, for security purpose, they are using this, encapsulation. So encapsulation, what is the meaning of validation and authentication? They are performing the encapsulation. So how to perform the encapsulation? Coming session, I will discuss one code. So we have one accessibility modifier is private, right? So by using this private keyword, we can, do the stuff. The private means all people are not able to access, only which people having the access, only username and password, only that people are able to access. So this thing we are performing by the encapsulation security stuff. So achieving dynamic method dispatching means calling the method for executing the dynamic from the different subclass of that type on the class of the subclass. Means this is the technically I have mentioned. So I can give the example of, we have a one ATM machine and we can withdraw the money from this ATM machine using the any bank ATM machine. This phenomena is called dynamic method dispatching. Okay, so advantage of considering the ATM machine and ATM card for the object, they have a internally loose coupling happen. Okay, and runtime polymorphism. So this step we will discuss in the coming classes for coding step. So today I am stopping here. Okay, people are not there, so I will send you notes as well, and I will send you also this